So after Pause with T came out, Mike ran into an old friend of ours in the neighborhood, and he's like, yo, I heard your record. You got 2 songs. And Mike's like, wait, no, there's probably like 16 songs on the record. Anyway.
From scrappy hardcore punk band to hip-hop pioneers to one of the biggest rap groups of all time, the Beastie Boys have had quite the career. Their most definitive statement, despite being seen as a flop on release, remains 1989's Paul's Boutique. A follow-up to the world-conquering Frat-tastic License to Ill, it joined De La Soul's 3 Feet High and Rising and A Tribe Called Quest The Low End Theory as the moment where rap music chilled out, foretelling the future rise of alternative hip-hop. It also made use of samples in a way that had never been heard before and never would be again. But how did it all come together? How did they get away with sampling the Beatles? And how did 3 Jewish kids from Brooklyn create one of the most important albums in 80s hip-hop? This is the story of Paul's Boutique. By 1987, the Beastie Boys, composed of Adam Horowitz, aka Ad Rock, Adam Yauch, aka MCA, and Michael Diamond, aka Mike D, were the biggest thing to ever happen to hip-hop. Their License to Ill album had sold 9 million records and peaked at number 1 on Billboard and number 2 on the R&B charts. The Beastie Boys did what Elvis Presley had done 30 years previously, taking a black musical form and brought it to mainstream America. But the biggest single off that album, Fight for Your Right to Party, confined them. The childish rebellion of its music video fitting in perfectly with the hair metal on MTV. We're doing what we want to do, and that's why the kids respect us. We're not listening to older people. We're going to do it. If for nothing else, just because they told us we can't. We are exercising our constitutional right to be fresh. But like most other rap songs to cross over to the mainstream before it, Fight for Your Right was treated critically as a novelty, most believing that the Beastie Boys would remain a one-hit wonder, never to return. The consequent world tour for License to Ill was plagued with issues. Because of the album's undertones of violence and misogyny, the public and press had a certain perception of the band as hoodlums, delinquents, and not something your children should be listening to. But that the Beasties were doing it with tongues firmly in cheek didn't translate to everyone, and the group spent their tour brushing up and kicking back against that image. As part of their stage show, they had audience-supplied go-go dancers in cages, as well as a giant hydraulic penis, while they drank and sprayed beer on the crowd throughout. By the time they hit the UK, the tabloid press were out in force.
We want to say this. It's f***ed up what you're all doing out here because it's saying a bunch of bullshit lies.
Their Liverpool show at the Royal Court Theatre ended 10 minutes in. The boisterous crowd hurling stuff at the band and ensuing a riot. As a result, Horowitz was arrested by the Merseyside police and charged with assault resulting in grievous bodily harm, supposedly having hit a kid with a beer can amid the scuffle. This is not what the band wanted to be known for. Returning home in late 1987, the band were on the verge of breaking up. Exhausted and barely talking to each other, they wanted to take some time off, but their label, Def Jam, wanted a follow-up as soon as possible, withholding $2 million worth of royalties off License to Ill until they recorded one. Said Diamond, "You haven't even gotten off the roller coaster." And the record company says, "Okay, here's your ticket for round 2. Give us more of the same right now." And you say, "Wait a minute, I'm dizzy and sick. I'm taking a break and getting some popcorn." Because of this, the Beastie Boys made moves to leave their label, namely moving away from their native New York and escaping to sunny Los Angeles for a year-long hiatus. In this time, Yauch and Diamond made new music with their own separate projects, and Horowitz dated Molly Ringwald and appeared in the lead role of film Lost Angels. During his time in Los Angeles, Horowitz met a production duo, Matt Simpson and John King, known by the joint moniker The Dust Brothers. They had recently helped shape LA rapper Tone Loc's first album, and were looking for their next project. We loved the Dust Brothers shit the second we heard it, and immediately wanted to work with them. Their stuff had an entirely different vibe than the tracks on Licensed to Ill. Funkier, jazzier, less classic rock, more R&B. It also pushed the boundaries of what we thought was possible with sample-based music.
A full clout tour, a full clout tour. People ask me when my tape is coming out, tour. Well, here it is, y'all, and it's clout.
One of the first tracks created for the album was originally called Full Clout. It, alongside another track, provisionally dubbed Dust Joint, were tracks that the Dust Brothers had already written to release as club instrumentals themselves. As such, they had a huge amount of sampling, making them some of the most complex tracks that would find their way onto Paul's Boutique. They put together some beats, bass lines and guitar lines, all these loops together, and they were quite surprised when we said we wanted to rhyme on it, because they thought it was too dense. They offered to strip it down to just beats, but we wanted all that stuff on there. While Dust Joint became Car Thief, Full Clout would be renamed after a vocal sample from Afrika Bambaataa and James Brown's 1984 song, Unity Part 2, Because It's Coming, that is used on the track. With choice snippets of Rose Royce's Car Wash soundtrack implemented. As well as Alphonse Mouzon. Thin Lizzy. It's the joy. And Ronnie Laws. The track is funkier and more 70s imbued than anything the Beasties had previously rapped on. Another audio clip on the track would suggest the band's change in go-to recreational drug and create a mini revolution of its own. Said co-producer Matt Dyke. The funny thing is, I heard bong hit sounds on 50 other CDs after that. Cypress Hill were clearly taking notes. On Shake Your Rump, the group pared down their ironic misogyny and instead rapped about pop culture, rumors about the band, and changes to the band's appearance. Those two tracks were the perfect showcase for what the band were trying to do next. As such, became their demo for the album and secured them a $3 million two-record deal with Capitol Records. But after producing that demo, the group faced several months of procrastination and writer's block. In total, Paul's Boutique would take almost 18 months and $1 million to complete. Though writing sessions for Paul's Boutique would involve a good deal of red wine and marijuana, they were also inspired by the music that was coming out at the time. Though De La Soul's 3 Feet High and Rising is compared to the album for its chillness and obvious weed influence, Paul's Boutique was already being mastered as the former was released. But Public Enemy and their 1988 album, It Takes a Nation of Millions to Hold Us Back, would be a big deal to the boys. That was the first time someone had approached a hip-hop album, like other artists. Rock artists is what I mean. Would approach an album. I don't think it was until Public Enemy that hip-hop really embraced the album format. But it was also inspired by their fresh LA setting and the shenanigans that the Beastie Boys were distracting themselves with. Along with hanging out with their new celebrity friends, they would often blow off steam by chucking eggs from the roof of the Mondrian Hotel where they were staying onto those waiting in line for the Comedy Store across the road. This inspired the song Eggman.
I looked out the window, seeing this bald head. Ran to the fridge and pulled out an egg. Sculpted on my sculpt, he had no hair.
Lost that shot and he was caught out there.
Egging had been a feature of the Beastie's downtime since the beginning. And the second verse of Eggman cribs lyrics from their hardcore era track, Egg Raid on Mojo. It also features one of the most interesting uses of sampling on the record. In the breakdown, the Dust Brothers have utilized two of the most famous classic horror themes and combined them into one terrifying whole. One of the main things that sets Paul's Boutique apart from Licensed to Ill and the majority of other hip-hop that was coming out in the late 1980s was its extensive use of sampling. On their previous effort, producer Rick Rubin had created Spartan metal-influenced backing tracks sprinkled with Led Zeppelin, Black Sabbath, and The Clash. Here, the Dust Brothers were using far-reaching sounds layered on top of each other, with sometimes a dozen plus sources per track, sometimes stretched beyond recognition, sometimes used as punchlines. According to Mike Simpson of the Dust Brothers, the record has between 100 and 300 separate samples. Though everyone involved is adamant that the samples were cleared, the $250,000 allegedly spent on doing so is nothing compared to today's licensing fees. The sampling was done to its absolute limits to see how much they could get away with. I remember having this discussion with Yauk, with him saying, let's just go completely over the top and sample everything. Let's make this the nail in the coffin for sampling. And that's kind of what happened. Some of those tracks are total plagiarism of the worst kind. But that's what's funny about that record. It's like, hey, we're ripping you off. To especially highlight this, Sound of Science is composed of four separate Beatles samples. Just because. It starts with When I'm 64, slowed down.
Now here we go, jumping science, jumping it all over.
Augmented by the intro screech from Back in the USSR. Then uses the guitar work from The End. Atop the drums from Sgt. Pepper's Lonely Hearts Club Band, Reprise. In the aftermath of the record's release, the Beatles' lawyers made noise about legal action, but the boys weren't fazed. Said Diamond, what's cooler than getting sued by the Beatles? Alongside the colourful production, their frat rhymes of old were replaced with an incisive rat-a-tat-tat triple team attack, tackling lyrical themes of cowboys, hobos, and their former home. The album also has time to comment on their struggles against Def Jam. On top of name-dropping everyone from Harry S. Truman to Alfred E. Newman, Shadrach compares the Beastie's travails with their former label to the biblical tale of its title. Explaining the story to Melody Maker, Yauk concluded, what happened was that they didn't get paid by their former record company, so they went to Capitol. The story has a good ending.
We were like this big group, Licensed to Ill. We're like internationally known and we're like 20 something years old. We're feeling ourselves and we thought we were a really big deal. And then we get signed to a new record label and all this. We work on this crazy record and we're like, this is it. We're like on top and all this stuff. And then nothing. Crickets.
Paul's Boutique was released on the 25th of July, 1989. It peaked at number 14 on the Billboard 200 charts the first week of September. After the massive hit that was Licensed to Ill, this was disappointing. the album then plummeted, leaving the chart for good by the end of November. The Beastie Boys had gone from dumbasses to wiseasses, and the public were not on board. Exacerbating the situation, behind the scenes at Capitol, the president who shepherded the group's signing was fired, the label deeming them and the album an expensive mistake, as such, barely promoting it. Because of its consequent commercial failure, the Beastie Boys just did not tour the album. And while there were promotional videos for Hey Ladies, Shake Your Rump, and Shadrach, the album never got the MTV-aided push of its predecessor. But unlike a lot of albums that bombed on release, but later became classics in their own right, at the time, Paul's Boutique got very good reviews. Many got what the band were going for and how far they had grown since their debut. David Hiltbrand of Time magazine wrote, "At the risk of sounding ridiculous, let us assert right off the bat that Paul's Boutique is as important a record in 1989 as Dylan's Blonde on Blonde was in 1966, the most daring, clever record of the year." In 2002, Pitchfork named it the third best album of the 1980s. Wrote William Bowers, "The Beasties expanded hip-hop's domain to name-check Salinger, Dickens, Galileo, and Newton. So ahead of its time, it should be on a 90s list." One of the main reasons for its classic status in popular music is that the album is truly unrepeatable. About a year after its release, record companies and hip-hop artists started becoming a lot more careful with what and the extent with which they were sampling due to prohibitive licensing fees. This was down to the landmark lawsuit against Biz Markie by Gilbert O'Sullivan. O'Sullivan suing the former for his use of Alone Again, Naturally, on Markie's 1991 track, Alone Again.
So he jetted off, leaving two tracks. Not at one time did homeboy look back.
Artists that were inspired by the Paul's Boutique sonic cocktail had to either raid record crates for obscure and lost samples, like DJ Shadow on Introducing, or the Avalanches on Since I Left You. Or go the non-commercial mashup route, such as with Danger Mouse's The Grey album. And I get an encore, do you want more? Cook and roll with the Brooklyn Boys. Oh, yeah. One last time, I need y'all to roll. Or Girl Talk's Night Ripper.
It was all a dream. I used to read Word Up magazine. Salt and Pepper and Heavy D up in the limousine.
Other big name champions of the album were Miles Davis, who reportedly once said he never tired of the record, and Public Enemy's Chuck D, telling Vibe that it was a dirty secret within the black hip-hop community that Paul's Boutique had the best beats. And beyond that, its casual pop culture references preempted the 1990s preoccupation with such in The Simpsons and the work of Quentin Tarantino. Afterwards, the Dust Brothers continued producing, their biggest hit confusingly being Hanson's Bop. But the production effort that seemed most like the next step on from Paul's Boutique was Beck's Odelay.
That was a good drum break.
A bizarro mix of obscure samples, genre-redefining instrumentation, and alt-rock smashes. As the 90s progressed, the Beastie Boys retained their role as one of the biggest groups in hip-hop, while returning to live instrumentation on Check Your Head and Ill Communication. But they were no longer the frat jokers of old. They had grown up. Though not fully understood on its release, Paul's Boutique remains as their true masterpiece, a record out of time, ageless and unique. Thanks for watching. What is your favorite track on Paul's Boutique? Comment down below. If you liked the video, why not like and possibly even subscribe? Over the last couple of weeks, I've had a big boost in views. I guess because people are staying inside and watching YouTube. And that's great. I hope you're all well. I'd also like to give a big shout out to all my patrons. You help this channel to continue to happen. Thanks a bunch. and I'll see you soon.